Thank you. I tend to see things as being built. That's all it means. And even when you paint, it's not the fluidity as much as the structure that I'm interested in. That's not to say I don't get sloppy and let the paint slob and roll and whatever it does, but my basic approach is as that constructional.
But there seems to be a point and counterpoint happening here, because you say you use a lot of architectural ideas and skills, yet you're salvaging work from the past. Where do the two meet?
It's not work from the past as much as it is stuff from the past.
Materials.
Yeah. And it doesn't matter whether how past it is. It's all interesting stuff.
And it could be his own work, and it could be
a
piece of paper from somewhere else.
I find things on the street or in the mail. We have great opportunities. Remember, Michelangelo never got junk mail, you know, so.
And we get a lot.
I see a wonderful use of color. You call color a secret weapon.
Yeah.
Can you want to talk about that a little bit?
I think it's a secret.
So he's not going to talk about it.
That's why I called it that. Well, I called that in part because, you know, I have a degree in art history, and one of the things I learned was that art historians rarely talk about color. They can't cope with it because it's really something only artists know about, designers as well, but you know, anybody who works with it. It can't be codified and it can't be intellectualized. And that's why, to me, it's a secret in that we all share it, work with it. But the historians, the critics, the writers,
the rest of the world doesn't
don't
know.
Get it. It never will. And and that's why it occurred to me. It is our secret weapon. So that's why I use the term.
It's great, by the way, I've appropriated it. I'm using it in my classes.
See?
But you know, the problem is that the reason that we don't know about color is that we can never really talk about color, because when we look at color and reproduction, it's never right. It's never the real color. So when my students start talking about color, I have to say, no, but that's not the way the painting really looks. It looks different in reality. So that's one problem we face. But it's true that we don't feel color the way an artist does.
Yeah. And it's feeling. I think it's the essence of what painting is the color.
But if I might interject something, I think the terrific thing about Larry's work is that there is feeling, there's intuition, it really sort of comes from within, but there's also a tremendous intelligence that's visible and that comes through. And the two together, they don't kill each other, they work together. And that's I think the secret, the real secret of his work.
Is there an inherent emotional effect that you hope viewers of your art will achieve or sustain?
What I hope they get? I don't know. It's pleasurable. I mean, that sounds like Matisse maybe, but just to kind of get lost in the beauty of color and form as well. We don't get opportunities like that in real life very much. That's why people buy paintings. Sometimes I take out things out of folders that I haven't looked at for years, just to kind of get into them, sort of. You kind of lose yourself. Maybe it's kind of a meditation or something. I don't know. But color does it for me. Some people, music will do it too. I happen to like music a lot and listen to a lot of music. I should also point out, it's taken me a long time to get to the point with color where I am now. You don't learn this quickly.
Catherine, is there a driving force behind the art that's exhibited here tonight?
Well, I think we've spoken about it. It's the color, it's the feeling, and there's the structure. There's always an architectural aspect, which Larry himself, I think, pointed out that it comes from his study of architecture. So it's it it